Fabulous. Good evening. Welcome to today's meeting of the Commonwealth Club of California, the place where you're in the know. You can find the Commonwealth online at commonwealthclub.org, on Facebook and Twitter, and on the club's YouTube channel. I'm Fred Blackwell, good evening, CEO of the San Francisco Foundation and the chair for today's program. It's really a pleasure to be here. This program is sponsored by the San Francisco Foundation and is part of the Foundation's series focused on racial and economic inclusion here in the Bay Area. And it's really a pleasure to be here. I want to thank the San Francisco Foundation's donors for their generosity in helping to make this happen, as well as the Commonwealth Club, KQED, and the panel participants who I'm sure you will enjoy today, this evening. Today's program is entitled, Is the Rising Tide Lifting All Boats? Race and Inclusion in the Bay Area. And in a minute, I'm going to hand it over to the panel to actually lead this discussion with you all. But I wanted to just make a couple of framing remarks, if I could, before turning it over to the panelists. And I wanted to start with a story. And really, it's a story that goes back to last week, which for me, as I'm sure a lot of people in the room and outside of the room, was a tough week. And the story is related to my son, who is 21 years old. And so when things like this happen, I go to him pretty quickly to make sure that he is okay and to kind of help him process stuff like this. And it was particularly difficult for me this time around because I was actually trying to process a lot of this stuff as well. And some of it I was able to make sense of, and some of it I wasn't. But I'm also that irritating father. I'm the one who not only reaches out to his son, but also every chance I get, I reach out to his friends and preach to them as well. And on Friday, I had a great experience because I actually was at the store and I ran into a bunch of his friends. And I was so happy to see them so that I could grab them by the collar and make sure that they were okay. And in part, as I usually do, some words of what I think are wisdom. And I brought up what was going on. And I wanted to make sure that they were being safe, that they were being thoughtful, that they were being attentive to the environment around them. And a funny thing happened. One of them said, oh yeah, Mr. Blackwell, you know, I know all about this stuff that's happening. I was talking to my dad, and he said, and I'm doing this, he said, I should tape my ID to the dashboard so that I don't have to pull out my wallet if I'm pulled over. And part of it was a little bit funny because it was the extreme part of how we respond, and, you know, we're a community that responds creatively to crises like that. But as soon as the kind of laugh that we shared with one another went away, it was actually really troubling. It was troubling because that's not the solution. You know, as creative as it is, the solution is not for people to figure out ways to safely pull out their wallets if they're pulled over. Is to figure out how we can create a system where that is not something that we even have to think about. The other thing that was troubling was I know that a lot of parents are having conversations with their kids about this, helping them to make sense of it, but there are only a few of us that both have to think about how they process this and think about how they can be safe and operationalize what's going on. And it just made me think that we are living in some cases some very different lives and experiences, although we walk in the same world. And what it brings me to, and the reason why I thought it was relevant for today, is it brings me to the Bay Area. And here in the Bay Area, it's not just around police issues or criminal justice issues where we are experiencing different things. People living in the Bay Area now are experiencing the Bay Area in very different ways based on sometimes where they live, sometimes what their race or ethnicity is, sometimes their family's economic status. And on the one hand, we've got this Bay Area that has a white-hot economy that's working well, where people are actually moving here and thinking about ways that they could participate in this economy because of all the opportunity that's out there. But on the other hand, there are a group of folks who really feel like the opportunities that exist in the Bay Area are not within their reach. That, you know, Silicon Valley could easily be 3,000 miles away in terms of the opportunities that they see are associated with that. And for that reason, we wanted to kind of frame this panel kind of provocatively. I mean, we live in a region that is, that we pride ourselves on values that are progressive in nature, where we there's a sense of freedom and that people are coming here that are able to express themselves in ways that they may not have been able to express themselves in other places. But in a lot of ways, the way we perceive ourselves is actually out of line with the reality of how people are experiencing the Bay Area, and large numbers of people are experiencing the Bay Area. So the question that we kind of really posed and that the panel is going to explore is this notion of kind of Bay Area exceptionalism reality, or is it really a myth for a lot of people when it comes to racial and economic inclusion and our ability to create a society and an economy that's inclusive? The panel is going to talk about that, and I want to introduce them really quickly. First, I want to start with James Bell. James is a civil rights leader, as well as a founder and executive director of the Hayward Burns Institute for Juvenile Justice, Fairness, and Equality. Since 2001, Mr. Bell has been spearheading a national movement to address racial and ethnic disparities in the youth justice system. He also has extensive experience in the international youth justice arena. He has assisted the African National Congress in the administration of youth justice system in South Africa, and recently worked with Chinese officials and policymakers on alternatives for proven risk associated with moving through the countryside, the cities. He holds a JD at Hastings School of Law, and we're really fortunate to have him here and to share some of his perspectives on kind of where we are in the Bay Area. Sitting next to him is Manuel Pastor, demographer, professor of sociology and American studies and ethnicity at the University of Southern California. We let him come up and do a little bit of critique of us. He also serves as the director of USC's Program for Environmental and Regional Equity and co-director of USC's Center for the Study of Immigrant Integration. He's the founding director of the Center for Justice, Tolerance, and Community at the University of California, Santa Cruz. He made his way up north a little bit there, and holds a degree in economics, PhD from University of Massachusetts at Amherst. To the left of James is our mayor of Oakland, Honorable Libby Schaff, inaugurated as the city's 50th mayor in January of 2015, born and raised in Oakland. Mayor Schaff previously served as a member of the Oakland City Council. She was also a top aide to Mayor Brown, Jerry Brown, that is, for those who are from San Francisco, and later served as public affairs director for the Port of Oakland. She has two decades of public service. I've had the pleasure to work with her in just about all those capacities that she's mentioned. She holds a JD from Loyola in Los Angeles, and her four stated areas of focus as mayor are holistic community safety, responsive, trustworthy government, sustainable, vibrant infrastructure, and equitable jobs and housing. So we're literally looking forward to hearing from her. And finally, and I'm about to turn it over to him, our moderator today is Joshua Johnson. He is the creator and host of the podcast Rocket Fuel Radio, as well as a lecturer at UC Berkeley's Graduate School of Journalism. He has previously worked at KQED Radio News, and prior to that, as an anchor reporter in his native South Florida. There, he helped to launch WLRN Miami Herald News, an innovative partnership between public radio and the Miami Herald. He's also been a frequent contributor to NPR Newscast, CBS News Radio, as well as America's public media marketplace, and he just said in the hallway, if you think he's taller than he looks on television, he's really taller than what he looks like on the radio. So Joshua, I'll turn it over to you.
Thank you, sir. Good evening. Welcome to the club. Glad to have you here to talk about a very important subject. We're going to try to get a lot of your questions and thoughts into the conversation, try to make it interesting, make it useful, make it fun. We don't have a ton of time. We got 55 minutes, but I work in radio. I can do a lot with 55 minutes. Mr. Bell, Professor Pastor, Mayor Schaff, welcome. Glad to have all of you here. We definitely want to talk about these issues of race and inclusion and what some of the problems are and how to address them. But let's start off by kind of defining the goal, defining what we're after. What would an ideal Bay Area look like in terms of racial inclusion and opportunity? Can we measure that? Can we quantify it? Is it just kind of a feeling that it feels like things are better than they were? How would we know racial opportunity, racial inclusion, racial equity if we saw it? Mayor Schaff, could I start with you and just work our way down the line? What would success in this endeavor look like?
Sure. The idea that your race does not in any way determine your opportunities and your success, not just opportunities, actual outcomes. I think I'm actually getting tired of talking about opportunities. I'm actually interested in outcomes. The disparities of zip codes, this idea that your zip codes now determine more of your fate than your genetic code. I'd like to see that done with. So I think that is something that we can measure, and the measurements right now do not look good.
James Bell, what does success look like?
I think success is, I would latch on to what Mayor Schaff said. I think if we look at zip codes and we reverse engineer in San Francisco from 94124 or 94110, the zip codes that people know, that we would look at the life outcomes of people in those zip codes and look at the policies, practices, and the systems and investment in those communities to see that our outcomes are better. And to me, the way that we know that this will happen is that people who feel that they are not subject to these practices actually care enough about them to make sure that outcomes are different. That's when we know that something is changing. Is that someone that lives in the marina and goes on Chestnut Street to get an $8 muffin actually cares what happens in Visitation Valley and the Alice P. Griffith homes and the Wisconsin Street projects that are about to be torn down, to actually make that connection between a smash and grab while you're on Valencia Street at a nice restaurant and what those people feel that feel like they are not a part of this Bay Area?
So it's partly quantifiable and partly cultural change.
So that you begin to see, you can see when there's investment coming your way.
Professor Manuel Pastor, how do we define success?
Well, two things first. I'm an economist by training and with PolicyLink, the co-creator of something called the National Equity Atlas. So of course we can measure it. data is your friend. I consider myself a nerd for social justice, so.
You're in good company, I think.
I think so. The second thing I should say is I really do want to thank the Bay Area for tolerating an Angeleno coming up here. My wife is from the Bay Area. She views it as a major act of charity for having married me, which may become clearer to you as the conversation goes on. To me, I think, as part of this National Equity Atlas, we actually calculated if you were to shrink the income and opportunity gaps between whites and people of color in the Bay Area, what it would add to the GDP of the Bay Area, and it's over $100 billion in extra annual GDP if you could get more people back into the labor market and actually close the income gaps that continue to persist as well. So there's tremendous gains for the entire Bay Area. And I think the way that we would measure it is two ways, which are really important to think about. One is to think about the opportunities that people have the mayor was talking about, James Bell was talking about, and the outcomes, as you were saying. But the other is about reversing the decades of damage that have been done. If we create a platform for young people to succeed, that's great. But if we've got so many people who are 40 and 50 who aren't able to come back into the labor market because of reentry problems, because of the way in which we've over-criminalized our populations, that's damage that needs to be reversed. If we think about how many people have been left in the shadows by an immigration regime that has not allowed undocumented Californians to be able to achieve their entire potential, so we have to pay attention to reversing the damage and not just creating the platforms to move forward.
Now let's talk about where things are now. Professor Pastore, you touched on some of these examples in the answer you just gave. But give me, any of you, give me an example, paint me a picture of something that you've seen, particularly in the Bay Area recently, that made you say to yourself, this has to change right now. Mm-hmm. What does this problem look like to you in your eyes, in your experience? Where are you seeing it in a way that just kind of viscerally hits you as saying, this should not be?
So I'd be happy to start on that one. You know, in my first State of the City address, I talked about under the green dot. So, you know, from an outside perspective, Oakland looks like it is doing really well. And that's when you look at the aggregated data, the trends are very promising. I mean, we have right now an unemployment rate of 5.6%. That is just stunningly low if you look at the history of unemployment in Oakland. But when you look under that, you know, it's a green dot on the map, right? It looks good. But when you disaggregate the data and you ask, well, is unemployment that low for all of our groups? It's pretty shocking to see the disparities. So unemployment for African Americans is more than three times the unemployment for whites in my city. So whites, 4.2%, African Americans, 14%. It's like two different cities inside the same geography. I think that's pretty disturbing.
James, what about you? Where have you seen this problem in a way that just viscerally strikes you?
For those of us that work in the justice sector, what strikes me is how little people know about where most of their money is being spent as the body politic. In the Bay Area counties, between 40 and 60% of your dollars are being spent on the apparatus of justice. The cars, the hall of justice, the jails, the caterers, the probation officers, the parole, the prosecutors, the indigent defenders, 40 to 60%. So therefore, all the rest of it, parks, elder services, all the positive things only have about 30%. And we'd say, well, we'd spend that. How are we doing in terms of safety? If we're spending that much money, are we getting that kind of return? The recidivism rate in San Francisco is 70%. And in the rest of the counties, it's not much different, between 60%. So you're using 60 to 70% of your dollars, 40 to 60% of your dollars, on a justice system that fails 70% of the time. Therefore, taking money away from other things. So what shocks me is how little data and accountability we have in the justice apparatus from the citizenry that allows them to be unaccountable and allows them to continue to operate with our dollars at this failure rate and having no data to tell you why they do what they do. That is shocking to me.
James, let me ask you a little bit more about the justice system, just kind of follow on the comment you made. Your work with the Burns Institute focuses largely on keeping children from being caught up in and for sure harmed by the juvenile justice system. Paint us a picture from your perspective. If a child of color in this system is going to be derailed from a life of opportunity and success, where is it most likely to happen? Are there one or two places, scenarios, situations that stand out to you as being critical turning points that maybe we could focus attention on first?
Yes. The outcomes for young people of color are tremendously deleterious when they first go into secure confinement. So the notion, and so let me just be clear, the context, Joshua, in which we do justice is we as a country for 400 years are addicted to incarceration as a primary instrument of social control. Everything that we fear Any behavior we fear, we first make it illegal before we even understand the sociological aspects. Texting, you get a cell phone, you can take a naked picture of yourself, it's illegal. It scares us, even though we bought the phones for the kids and adults put the cameras in the phones. And so you're asking them to not act like teenagers. So when you do normal adolescent behavior and you criminalize it and put them in a 6x9 room is where we have the most problems with young people. Our education friends will tell you that it's ninth grade. That something about where a teenager is, that transition around the ninth grade from middle school, crazy hormones, to high school, being cool and, you know, being a semi-adult, a lot of people in neighborhoods of persistent, concentrated, and often geographically isolated poverty can't make that transition. And so when they act out, what we do is use our primary instrument of social control for them, and that's incarcerate them, rather than give them services, intervention, and the things that we try to do for our children. Because I would bet that if we took a poll of 40 people in this room and asked how their teenagers are doing, it won't be a pretty picture. But they don't expect them to be
concerned go over the
room. Right, right. And they don't expect them to be at 375 Woodside or in San Leandro in Alameda County or wherever. They are going to do what it takes to try to wrap their children around to make sure they don't stay in this system.
Mayor Schaff, let me ask you about Oakland. Oakland is a great city. It's a tough city. I think it gets a little bit of a bad rap often that it doesn't deserve, but there are a lot of issues in Oakland that you know very well need addressing. A lot of deeply entrenched issues. There are efforts underway to address many of them. I'm sure we're going to talk about them quite a bit as the hour goes on. But just by way of framing your work in this, as it relates to race and inclusion, I think a lot of people will look at the mayor or the governor or the president and say, we elected you, go fix it. And that ain't the way life works. Give us a clear picture of what it is that you actually have the power to do as an executive mayor to influence these issues. What are some of the things that you can do, can bring, can attract, can accomplish, can leverage from your seat as it relates to issues of race and inclusion? And where are the areas where you really do need residents to step in and take over?
Well, honestly, I don't think anyone does anything very successfully alone. And so a lot of what a mayor does is try and convene and generate, you know, education and awareness and action. And there are 10 million examples that I'm like itching to give you, but let me just try and do a few. So in Oakland, I'm a strong mayor, so I'm not actually a legislator. I don't vote on the laws. I'm not a member of the city council. But I do get to make a lot of the funding decisions, and I still have considerable influence as the mayor when I do make proposals. So for example, right now we're crafting a bond measure that we want to put on the November ballot. And obviously a huge issue in Oakland is displacement. Traditionally, people have thought about kind of solving the displacement issue by building new affordable housing, which is something that we absolutely need to do. We don't have a sufficient supply of regulated, kind of reserved for low and very low income tenants housing, particularly in the Bay Area. But my higher priority, which is not the traditional way of addressing this, is to try and bring affordability to people where they are living right now. The idea that a family who has chosen a place as their home has to be forced to leave that home, even if it's to move to a different part of the city, the social network they lose, the sense of community, all the things that go with where you live, particularly if you have children, is tremendous. And I speak from personal experience. Having been displaced myself. And so we're looking at some different strategies as priority expenditures for this bond, where we're actually looking to acquire, fix up, and put affordability restrictions onto existing housing with low-income families that are already living there, bringing these protections to them. And that's not a traditional way that cities have done this. But as mayor, that is a policy priority I've put forward. Now I have to sell it to my council, but that's an example. Police policies. We in Oakland have made some very dramatic changes around the way that we do policing. And trust me, I recognize we have a lot more to do. But for example, we require our officers to inform people of their right to refuse a discretionary consensual search. Several years ago, our police force used to do 3,000 of these discretionary consensual searches a year. This last year, we did about 280. That is such a less oppressive way of policing. That's a good example of a policy change. We've changed our policies around car chases, foot chases. We've instituted de-escalation training, mental health crisis training, unconscious bias training. All these things have created kind of provable changes in how policing impacts our communities. We're arresting roughly a third of the people we used to arrest. We are using force 25%, 75% reduction in use of force in Oakland. And we are one of the few cities in America that is actually getting safer. I believe these things go together, but those policy changes are things that a mayor can talk about. The last thing I'll say, and then, because I think this will flow in well, the fragmentation of governmental systems is not designed to accomplish better outcomes. So if I invest in those parks and libraries that you talked about, if I invest in really changing the way my police force does policing so that they are compassionate guardians of the community rather than the gateway to a dysfunctional criminal justice system, I don't see any savings in the reductions, the huge reductions in the incarceration costs, because that's not in my budget. And so the incentives for actually fixing the problems have not been really built into the way that the governmental systems are designed and fragmented. But as mayor, that's one of the things that I can do and am doing with really championing the creation and empowerment of a joint powers authority that we have in Oakland with the city, the county, and the school district. How we are starting to try and see ourselves as a unified whole that is here to serve the whole individual, the whole family.
I'm glad you brought up that point. Somebody actually submitted a question about how we deal with these issues regionally, and Professor Pastore, I know some of your recent writing has had to do with the way that governments kind of pursue, your recent writing was about progressive politics, but in a more interdisciplinary, you know, states working with regions, working with counties, working with cities to kind of further agendas together. And I want to get to that a little bit later on. Keep the questions coming, by the way. I'll start throwing those in just a few minutes. But first, Professor Pastore, first, I need to ask you about white people. And you're biased. You're biased. You can't give me. I need an outside expert. When we talk about race and inclusion, we're almost always talking about Black and Latino people. This may sound like a screwy question, but I'm asking it sincerely. Why should white people care about this? At what point does racial inequality actually affect whites in tangible, inescapable ways?
Well, I think there's, thank you for recognizing my expertise on white people.
My fingers are crossed, man. Don't let me down.
Muchas gracias, big buddy. I want to say that there's sort of two levels to this. One is interests and the other is values, right? Mm-hmm. And actually, you're right. Thank you for mentioning. We just finished a book that's called Equity, Growth, and Community, in which we wind up looking at the relationship between income inequality, residential segregation, and city-suburb splits, and ask what happens to metropolitan economic growth over time, whether or not it's sustainable. And it turns out that the inequality, residential segregation, big splits between city and suburbs actually have diminishing impacts. They sort of hurt the growth trajectory. Now, you might be looking at me and thinking this is probably just the research of a leftist professor from Southern California, came up with the idea in a hot tub, you know. This squares with research from such radical institutions as the Cleveland Federal Reserve and the International Monetary Fund, well known for their Marxist political economy leanings. So there's actually been a sort of shift in the way that we think about this, because we're realizing that when there's tremendous social separation and you're leaving so many people behind, you're not really realizing the full potential of the human capital that's available in a region. And you're also creating a lot of dissension, like an expensive policing and criminal justice system that actually hurts your economic potential as well. So there's interest reasons, but there's also values reasons. What kind of world do we want to live in? Do we want to live in a world where our neighbors are terrorized? Do we want to live in a world in which young black men have to worry about whether or not they're taping their ID to the dashboard of their car? Do we want to live in a world in which young children of immigrants come home every day worried about whether or not their parents are going to be there? Do we want to live in a world in which there's such a spirit of unforgivingness, both in our criminal justice system, in our economy, that people who are doing and trying to do the right thing can't make it? I don't think that's the world that anyone wants to live in. So I think there's interest reasons. Like I told you, there's $100 billion extra dollars on the table if we close income inequality by race in the Bay Area. But there's also, who are we as people, and who do we want to be as people? I was asked this morning to read for a program that's called Freedom School. It came out of the Freedom Schools in the 60s, but currently it's a program for kids. These are kids in South LA where they get taught reading and social justice all at the same time. It's done by the Children's Defense Fund and Community Coalition. And the quote that I chose to use was a quote from Clarence Darrow, which was basically that I won't be free unless everybody else is free. And I think we need to realize that at a deep moral and spiritual level. We can move people to change through interests. We can only sustain change through values.
Let me throw out this question before we
that's
dive in.
Weird for an economist to say, I know.
But you know, that's why I gave you that question.
Yeah.
That's why I let you jump on that grenade. Thank you very much. Before we go to some of the questions from the club in general, I wonder if anyone can put a pin on whether this equity gap in the Bay Area, particularly as it relates to blacks and Latinos, is an issue of race or an issue of racism. Are people of color just unlucky? I mean, did I just kind of lose the genetic lottery? Or are there forces here that you see are actively today keeping people out? Is this just an issue of race, or are we talking about issues of racism?
You know, I appreciate that question, Joshua, but it sounds like a frame from media that I'm not going to accept. And that frame is race versus racism, which is ahistorical. You can't separate out. You know, John Adams, one of our founding fathers, said, power always believes it has a great soul. And so it's like, no, you don't need Martin Luther King Boulevard to be Geary. Why don't you just run it through the park where nobody will go, because we think it's better for you, right? There's this sense of separating how we got to where we are. And the point is, it is race-based policies that have us in the position that have law enforcement being the face of government in many communities. And that is not right to law enforcement. Law enforcement, as you've heard people say recently, I've been saying for 2 years, are being asked to do the jobs that society has given up on. What are you supposed to do with a homeless person if you're law enforcement and they're throwing urine on you? You can take them in or you can let them go, but you can't build them a house. But if we keep putting them in the position of having to deal with these people, we aren't dealing with them. We're asking law enforcement to deal with them. We are giving them the dregs. And so essentially, what these policies, Joshua, that I would say is, it is race and it is racism. And it is not about individuals, because the way the jobs are constructed have race built into them because of how they were formed. In Southern California, Latinos were sterilized because they didn't perform IQ tests. And under the eugenics of the day, mesomorphic, where your brain and your skull structure, you know, eugenics, that we can prevent crime by the way you look. And so the Latinos in the Whittier School in Southern California, and the Filipinos didn't look a certain way. They looked criminal. And the crime prevention method of the day, 1915, 1920s, was sterilization. It wasn't called the exclusion laws. It was called the Chinese exclusion laws, not the, oh, by the way, are you Chinese exclusion laws? It was the Chinese exclusion laws. So these policies that have devolved to today are deeply race-based, and deeply people feel that. And so when you try to separate out the issues of today, these stories, even though not covered in the media, travel generations through people. And that pain and that hurt and that distrust. And so I just ask people, so give me the day when we became colorblind in the United States. Tell me what minute it was, what day it was, where all of a sudden you wouldn't say that there was a Latino, a white woman, and a black person, and a black guy that was the moderator on the stage. It's like, oh, I don't know what color they were. I don't know. They were. I don't see color. Really? The point is to be color smart, not color blind. We're not going to be color blind. We need to be color smart and to have equity as our values, as Manuel has said. And so the racism, I reject. It is, when are these policies going to be unfettered in terms of who you are and where you live and what we think of you?
I do take your point on that. I take your point on that frame and shaking that up, so thank you. And I like the idea, and speaking of policies, we're gonna get more into that as well as into law enforcement in just a moment. We have plenty of questions from the audience, but first I must remind you that you are listening to the Commonwealth Club of California program. We're discussing race and inclusion in the Bay Area with James Bell, the executive director of the W. Hayward Burns Institute for Juvenile Justice, Fairness, and Equality. Manuel Pastor, a professor of sociology, American studies, and ethnicity at the University of Southern California, and Oakland Mayor Libby Schaff. I'm Joshua Johnson. You can hear more Commonwealth Club programs on the radio, and you'll find links to the club's podcast and YouTube videos online at commonwealthclub.org. Time to go to some questions from the audience, starting with Mayor Schaff, but I'd love to get everyone's perspective on this as it relates to race and law enforcement. What is your perspective on the Black Lives Matter protests in Oakland? How justified were they, and how should the police respond?
Well, I think you can't ask a ubiquitous question like that because there have been many protests. If you're talking about the ones last week, you know, I always say I don't condone unlawful activity, but I deeply respect and understand the rage and the pain that compelled people to come together and to protest. We had, I mean, the official account was 2,000. We think there were more than like 3,000. People who came together in Oakland on Thursday night to just be together in this moment of pain. And I felt that all things considered, with 3,000 very emotional people, things went relatively well. I think the police department was present in a way that facilitated a peaceful protest. There were some very small acts of vandalism, which there were arrests for, because we're trying to separate those things out in Oakland. So I think there's a bigger conversation than just like, how did the protests go? Can I use this excuse to kind of talk a little bit about your last question about
Please.
Race versus racism?
Please.
I think that we have to remember, we're so focused on the racist individual, the racist police officer. As opposed to recognizing that racism is baked into our governmental institutions. And that these have been hard weeks for those of us in government. You know, Oakland, California prides itself on loving its diversity. It's one of the only cities that anyone has ever heard of when residents are asked an open-ended question on a survey, what do you love most about living in Oakland? The vast majority of people answer, it's diversity. And yet, with all our good intentions, we operate in government institutions that are built on the foundations of absolute racism. And some of that is things that we don't always see and recognize. And so I just think that our opportunity is not just to address the racist individual, whether that's conscious or unconscious bias, but to recognize the systemic changes that are producing unfair results.
One more question for you, Mayor, and then Professor Pastore, I'd like you to chime in on this because this is related to your research. Mayor Schaaf, do you believe that there is sufficient dialogue amongst the Bay Area's elected officials on how to solve these issues regionally? If not, what needs to be done to kick off those discussions?
Okay. Well, I mean, I get back to what I was talking about before, which is that the fragmentation of governmental systems are not designed for us to produce better results. The incentives have not been put in. But I think that's the kind of conversation that we're starting to have now. I'm thankful for the collective impact movement, which recognizes not just the importance for different governmental or public agencies to band together, but for community to also be woven into that collective effort to align our resources in such a way that we aren't just doing our own separate work in our own separate silos, but that we are actually moving the needle on these issues that are so important to us.
Professor Pastore, what have you seen, if anything, that works in terms of regional collaboration on issues like race? Well, there's no issue like race, but on issues of race that are large and entrenched and as the mayor said, that are kind of baked into the society. What works? What does it take for different agencies to get out of their silos?
So I'm going to do the academic thing and answer a question you didn't quite ask, then get to the question.
That's politician thing.
I'm surrounded.
But I just want to get back to the question that James picked up on, which is I say this in a way that would get bleeped out usually, so I'll say it more politely. What I say to my students is there's a difference between disadvantage and being systematically messed over, right? So I've got a bad knee. I had a car accident when I was young. It's hard for me to run. That's a disadvantage, right? Being criminalized by the police is being systematically messed over. And so I think if we tease that out, that's where the racism comes in, and I think it's important. You know, you should look for inspiration for regions coming together in places you might not expect. So one place you might not expect is Jacksonville, Florida, which in the 1960s was a place that was infamous for something that was called Axe Handle Saturday, when white vigilantes, you know this from being from Florida, beat up young African-American civil rights protesters, and the police only intervened in order to protect the white guys with the axe handles. It became a very famous marker in Jacksonville's history. Jacksonville currently, though, has something called the Jacksonville Community Council, which brings together people from all different walks of life to focus in on a problem together. And they've created not only a consolidated city-county government, which has led them to make certain kinds of structural decisions together, but they've also created these mechanisms for people to get to know one another, have the data to look at problems, and then be able to address them. Each year, this Jacksonville Community Council, which brings together people from all different walks of life, picks an issue like pre-K, the ninth grade transition, et cetera, and puts a lot of, you know, systematic resources at trying to address those things. How do you get there? I think one really important thing for the Bay Area is the following. The Bay Area suffers from something which in Spanish we call se cree muy muy, which if you know Spanish, it means he believes himself to be very, very, right? The Bay Area is like super conceited about itself, right? So, I mean, you're incredibly diverse. That's really great. You're number two in diversity in the country from the 150 largest metropolitan areas. You're also host to the only county, San Francisco County, that's slated to become white, more white in the next 20 years. It's going to have a lot more whites and a lot more small dogs, too.
You don't want to go to that Board of Supervisors meeting, Manuel. No. I can tell you where the dogs can walk. Yeah. It just gets
competing
people crazy.
Competing for the $8 muffins, right?
Right.
You think you have this rip-roaring economy? It's true, your GDP has been going up, but for the last 30 years, you've had subpar job performance. Since 1990, the number of jobs you're creating is actually lower than in the rest of the United States. You seem rich because you've got entrepreneurs that are making a ton of money, and you've got this increase in working poor that's been going on, and this increase in a lack of employment. It's a wonderful place to live, and now nobody can afford to live here, right? So I think the first thing that the Bay Area, and I mean, I see the mayor doing this in Oakland, is shock yourself out of your own self-absorption and pride and say, what are the issues? Now, you know, you probably look down on us in Los Angeles, right? And in many ways you should. Not at all, actually. I just say that so you won't throw things at me, right? But, you know, we got shaken by the 1992 civil unrest in which a city was, and a county was angry enough about police brutality and economic inequality to burn itself down. And it was easy for those of us who are progressives to say, gosh, it's got something to do with the first George Bush administration or an unfair economy or the police department, and it had to do with all those things. But also, if we've got a city angry enough to burn itself down and progressives have not been able to channel that into positive social change, then you're not really doing it, right? And for the last 25 years, LA has become a hotbed of social justice organizing, right? Regional thinking, raising the minimum wage, incorporating immigrants, doing all sorts of really great things. So I think kind of getting out of really accepting the shock of, if we keep going in this direction, then Bay Area is not going to be the place that people are so proud of, and then saying, what are the concrete strategies to get there? I think that's the first and important step.
Let me go to another question from the audience, which actually brings in an aspect of the discussion on race that is very specific to, it's quite relevant in the Bay Area, and that, quite honestly, I think often gets left out. Thank you for bringing this up. I'm remiss in not saying it. Why are Asians and South Asians always left out of discussions about race? Ditto for Arabs and Middle Easterners, all of whom are a huge part of the Bay Area's demographics. What does that conversation look like in the Bay Area? I mean, granted, Asian is a gigantic swath of the population, and you can't just, we lump all Asians together in the census, but you can't really culturally, especially in the Bay Area, when every different culture that's encompassed in that lives wildly different lives. How do we have, is that a different conversation from the Black and Latino conversation? Are the issues that different? Is it all one conversation? How do we wrap our arms around that?
Well, we're laughing because we just had this discussion before you guys showed up. So back in the green room.
That's what I get for being late.
the brothers were late.
And you know, now, I don't appreciate you bringing that up out loud.
All right, okay, I'm sorry. All right, I'm sorry.
I would have hoped that we were having a very pleasant conversation, and then all of it, we're just going to forget that he. Go ahead, Mayor Schaff. What were you trying to say?
No, I'm not allowed to be funny, so
no,
I'm just going to
no,
keep
that's
it
okay.
All boring.
We got mad jokes on that side of the stage, so it's okay.
This is the boring side of the stage here.
Exactly.
It's fine. We were discussing this very, very issue. And so, you know, back to Under the Green Dot, the need to disaggregate this data is critical. So, you know, we don't even know what our issues are because we aren't even looking at them. You know, Oakland just recently is a sponsor of a bill in the assembly to require disaggregation of race data for the allocation of workforce training dollars. Yeah. So this year, Oakland got a huge cut in our workforce training dollars because, like I said, our unemployment is way down. And yet we are supposed to focus our workforce effort on vulnerable communities, low-income communities of color, disabled folks, formerly incarcerated folks. Those are specific groups that are called out, and we want to focus on them, and yet we got all our funding cut because the people who aren't them are doing just fine. So this need to disaggregate data and make policy decisions. You know, equal is not equitable. That is, I think, one of
the
really...
Say that again.
Equal is not equitable. Equal is not fair. We have to recognize where people are, and it is not equal. So if we want to promote fairness and justice, we cannot just keep on spreading stuff equally.
Professor?
Well, I mean, I think that's the spirit of the local control funding formula, in which now state resources to education are being targeted better to low-income students and also to clusters of low-income students. But the point you were saying, I think, is really important. The Asian population is very, very diverse. It's simultaneously in the state of California got higher median household income and higher poverty rates because it's a quite bifurcated community. It's got very high college going rates, even higher than college completion rates, even higher than for native born whites. But at the same time, you've got significant populations that even made their way out of high school, particularly the South Asian population. And they often get left out of the picture. There's something else about, I think, that's very important. It's one of the, you know, the Bay Area's got one of the largest shares of Asians of a metropolitan area, it in Seattle. And one thing that's also very interesting about this spot, you know, in the 2012 re-election of President Obama, the banner statistic that everybody kept referring to was that 71% of Latinos voted for Obama. They were struck by that. Do you know what share of Asians voted for Obama? 73%. Higher than the Latino population, creeping up on the African-American population. Why? Because the Asian population in the United States, according to polling data, has a very unique characteristic. They can hold two ideas in their head at the same time. And that idea is that they're actually believers that government has a role to play in providing the platforms for opportunity, and they're also believers that people need to step up and work hard and, you know, move ahead, and it's up to people to succeed. But it's also up to, as we've thought in the past, that was the sort of DNA of California, that we both need to provide the structures of opportunity, and when we do, we expect people to step up. So this is a very critical population not to leave out of this conversation, not only because it's a diverse population in terms of the income experience, et cetera, but also because it's a very important population in terms of political alliances for moving California forward.
Let's keep going with a few more questions. Somebody from the audience asked about tech firms and encouraging companies to hire populations that reflect the communities. I'm going to expand on your question if I may, since Silicon Valley is full of hackers, but a lot of them seem to be hacking consumer tech, financial tech, biotech. Very few of them seem to be hacking poverty or hacking equity or hacking justice. And I can only take that to mean that you don't like a real challenge. Talk to the budding tech entrepreneur, you know, this young person who's looking to be the next Elon Musk or whatever it is they're trying to be, and ride this rising tidal wave of Silicon Valley money. What is your sales pitch to try to get them to hack some of these ideas of racial inclusion, to put their brilliance and their creativity and their work ethic to solving this problem instead of trying to create the next Pokemon Go? Where's the incentive?
Well, you know, I get teased a little bit for having invented this funny word called techquity. And techquity is the idea that we need to hold our tech companies accountable for having a workforce that is inclusive and reflects the diversity of the cities where they are and the consumers that they enjoy the support of. But also that we want tech companies to be more mission-driven. How many more photo sharing apps do we really need? And so that's a challenge that we put out all the time. And what are, you know, this incredibly rich new sector, what are they doing to invest in pipelines of opportunity for that diverse workforce that can only benefit them? You know, we have got to enjoy the full talent pool that's out there. And it's also this idea, I like to think that in government, technology is a tool for addressing equity challenges. We've spent too long looking at technology as the enemy, the digital divide. I think it's time we talk about the digital bridge.
And I have to, as you say that, I'm remembering Richard Carranza, who's the superintendent of San Francisco Unified. I interviewed him a while back, and he talked about his efforts to try to get tech companies to invest in the school system, not so much because, oh, we're a school system and we need the money and please, it's the nice thing to do, but because, you know, you could go around the world and try to recruit talent for your company, or you could just grow it here. Like the kids in SF Unified are brilliant. They're great. And if you would just invest in the kids who are already here and OUSD, and there's so many smart kids here that just need like that much more investment. And if you would just put your money here, you could see your investment reap a dividend over time. You wouldn't have to fling a job application around the world and import somebody. We got seeds. All they need is water and love, basically, was his argument. So I do take the point.
And there are some examples of technology companies hacking disparity. One that I love, in fact, I think I saw a forum about it right here on this stage, is Kiva. Kivaorg.org, that's based here in San Francisco. I mean, we know that part of low-income communities of color getting access to capital to start and grow small businesses, when that's always determined by your collateral, your credit score, that is a barrier that is inequitable. And so Kiva has hacked that by asking people like you and me to crowdsource zero interest loans for local entrepreneurs that live right in our communities. And so, you know, if you want to do something great for your world today, go to kiva.org and lend some of your money. You get it back. It's really great. But lend some of your money. You're not doing anything with it except for buying $8 muffins.
You know, James earlier disagreed with the premise of one of your questions. The only disagreement I have with the premise here is that Pokemon Go may be an okay thing to have invented.
Oh, so, for goodness sake.
Very exciting. But I do want to say that I think that the challenge ahead is to try to figure out how you create an economy that blends innovation and inclusion, right, high tech and high need. And I think that turning the creative power of the Silicon Valley on some of these issues would be important. I don't think that happens without a personal connection, and it's important to think about that as well. I've been struck by the way in which Mark Zuckerberg from Facebook funded something called Forward.us, which has been trying to do comprehensive immigration, support efforts for comprehensive immigration reform in the United States. Somewhat clumsily at first, because that's how high-tech people do it when they actually stumble into the real world, right? But it's gotten better over time. What motivated him to do that is not what you'd think. It wasn't that he needed high-tech Asian engineers into the Silicon Valley. They had no problem getting the H-1B visas. He was actually teaching a coding class, and as he was teaching a coding class, a kid got up and said, "This is great. I'm learning all this stuff, but I'm never going to be able to use it because I'm undocumented and I'm not going to be able to work." And it was that personal connection that led Zuckerberg to realize that the immigration issue is a bigger issue. So I think we need to do the work that moves people, not just based on their interests, but again, based on their values and on their human connections, because that's how we'll create lasting change.
We're running out of time. I'm just trying to squeeze a few more questions in. We did get one question about gentrification, which seems to be a big, big driver of the race and inclusion gap. Now, I don't want to beat up on the newcomers. I was a newcomer myself 6 years ago. I think tomorrow marks 6 years since my first day of work at KQED, so I'm just a baby in the Bay Area. But there are plenty of people here who seem to have no interest in the environment around them other than the outdoors, where they like to go frolic in the woods, and the neighborhood where their favorite gastropub is. Like, that's about it. How do we get newcomers to the Bay Area to recognize this issue, respect the issue, and integrate into the existing communities rather than just try to kind of let what is there shrivel and die on the vine so that they can put down roots? How do you do that?
Well, first, I want to congratulate the San Francisco Foundation, Fred, Judith, and their team for trying to take on this question of equity in all the complexities that have been raised here on the stage. It seems to me that government has to be leading in this area. And when government is following in this area, as I've suggested before, it comes to law enforcement. So I think of things that happen to people so that when you move into this community, you should understand, I'm sorry, you're not in Dayton anymore, you're not in wherever you came from, because these are the issues in the community that you're coming to. When I first moved to Florida from San Francisco, you know, I don't care if you were rich or poor, everybody had bugs because it's the swamps. And so, I'm sorry, bugs come with your place.
right? So I learned that. In San Francisco, it's like, no, we don't have bugs. What do you mean? Ew, right? And they're like, no, everybody has bugs because it's Florida. When you come to the Bay Area, you need to understand that there's a housing shortage and that housing isn't just a place to drop your backpack. There are social issues with it. And that the policy of the leaders and government have to make that clear. Very difficult in a market capital society. If somebody says, I have a shack and it's worth $2,000 and you'll spend $2 million for it, there's not much government can do. But we must face this problem and not let law enforcement be the place. I can tell you right now, Lake Merritt, Uptown in Oakland, Valencia Street, The Mission, Dolores Park, these are the hotbeds of proxy of where gentrification lives. And wherever gentrification is, I don't know if Manuel and his colleagues have done it, but I can tell you a gentrifying neighborhood is a neighborhood with misdemeanor crime going up because people feel they have nowhere to go and they are gonna go, they are gonna do something that is born out of desperation. So the person that's running in Lake Merritt and we can't barbecue there anymore and we can't do this like we used to do, and now somebody's gonna call the police when they say you can't do it, and I'm gonna say, well, why are you doing that? And then I'm gonna come back and then I'm gonna say something and I'm gonna call you out. Now it's on and we're asking the justice system to fill this up. Same thing at Dolores Park. I grew up in this park. This park was ours. And now we got all these people in this park. You can't act like that isn't happening as government and must take this on. And so my sense is that gentrification is a huge opportunity to engage equity. And the smart leaders will get ahead of it because it's not going away. It's just going to get more violent because people feel more desperate and people feel more pissed off. I was in the Flora restaurant in Oakland because we got run out of San Francisco. My nonprofit got run out of San Francisco and we're in Oakland. Glad to be there.
Welcome.
Thank you. We're glad to be there. And I'm sitting there with a Asian professional, a Latino professional, and a Black professional. We're all professionals. We're sitting in Flora having our little salad. And we're like, look at, and they're like, look at Uptown. Look at this. Look at this. And they're going, better don't always mean better. They're like, you know what? This is fine, but it was just as fine the way it was. Now, those are professionals expressing that attitude. And what that is we don't like the way these people are coming in and acting like this neighborhood is there. Now, are they paying taxes and is it economic development? Yes. I don't know the conundrum to this, but what I know it ain't is ignoring it, not getting ahead of it, and then having the police have to try to clean it up when people go off on each other at the first Friday.
Well, I certainly think we can agree on what... Yeah, I hear that. Yeah. I think we can certainly agree that's not the way to handle it. In our last few minutes, I want to try to wrap up with two real...
You're so mean not to let me opine on that one, because that is my 24/7 job, but it's okay.
That's okay.
We can move on.
Okay, I'll let you start with this one. I'll let you start with this one, and I will let you answer the last question last. I'll let you have the last word. How's that? I wanted to go right down the line really quickly, starting and ending with Mayor Schaff, about just some quick ideas for what people can do to try to influence this. You know, you've heard this hour-long program, these lovely people have been sitting here, and some of them are definitely thinking, well, what the heck do you want me to do about it? Give me a real super quick example, lightning round, quick example of something that anybody listening to this, watching this, or in this room can do to further the cause of race and inclusion, briefly.
Go to theoaklandpromise.org, learn all about it, make a contribution, or volunteer as a mentor to a first-generation kid that is going to college.
Find out how much your county is paying for justice and see what your recidivism rate is. And when those people come in front of the Board of Supervisors to get their budget, somebody is there asking questions about why is it that we have about 3 Black people in San Francisco and we got 18 locked up?
Two of those three. Right, exactly.
That's right. Like, we make that look at each other. You still here?
Yeah, I'm still here.
Still here. Professor Pastor, one quick thing that anybody can do.
The one quick thing is to not think there's one quick thing. Right. That there's a huge set of intersecting issues that we need to work on together. It's housing, it's employment, it's the criminal justice system, it's our own attitudes. And when people reduce it to one, and I know that's not what you're trying to do, you're just trying to be quick, and professors don't go with that. is when you try to reduce it to just one thing, you're left thinking that you can change somebody's life with one intervention. Lives are formed by many interventions.
Mayor Schaff, let me give you the last word on the last question, and we are just out of time. This is pretty heavy stuff that no one has really figured out a solution to. And Oakland is often in the spotlight for a lot of these issues, especially with OPD and with the legacy issues of gentrification and employment. As Oakland's mayor, what gives you the most hope? Where do you look for reassurance that your city and this region will be a place that closes this gap for good?
Yeah. I just believe at the end of the day that instead of turning at each other, we will turn towards each other. That love wins, and that that compassion and love will rule the day, and that we do these things because they are the right things to do. I do have that faith in humanity and our desire to do the right thing.
As the professor said, if these are the values by which we want to govern this community and build this community, then that will hopefully win the day. That's Oakland Mayor Libby Schaff. Manuel Pastor, demographer and professor of sociology, American studies, and ethnicity at the University of Southern California. And James Bell, the executive director of the W. Hayward Burns Institute for Juvenile Justice, Fairness, and Equality. Thank you all for being with us. Much appreciated. Thanks for your time. This program has been sponsored by the San Francisco Foundation and is part of the San Francisco Foundation series focused on people, place, and power in the Bay Area. Thank you so much for joining us on the radio, on TV, online. Thanks to everybody here who packed the clubhouse. I'm Joshua Johnson, and this meeting of the Commonwealth Club of California, the place where you're in the know, is adjourned. Good night, everybody.